So now I have the privilege and honor to give the intro to our wonderful speaker, Dr. Nadal. And I just want to say that he has a special place in my heart because Dr. Nadal was named after St. Gerard Magella. So of course, when I saw him and I said, you've got to be on our board. You were named after the saint. And so we're so pleased to have him on our board and most especially pleased to hear his presentation. Here is his biography. Dr. Nadal earned his bachelor's degree in psychology and philosophy from St. John's University in New York, and then studied divinity at St. Joseph's Seminary before leaving to pursue a three-year course of post-baccalaureate pre-medical and science studies at Columbia University, where he also worked in the Department of Psychiatric Epidemiology as a research assistant. He then returned to St. John's University to earn a Master of Science degree in Cellular and Molecular Biology, a Master of Philosophy in Microbiology, and a Ph.D. in Molecular Microbiology. That's a lot of words. Followed by postdoctoral studies in microbial genetics at the City University of New York. Dr. Nadal has for several years been a leader in the pro-life movement, speaking and writing extensively about such scientific issues such as stem cell research, cloning, the link between abortion and breast cancer, and the effects of contraception and abortion on women's bodies, to name a few topics. Dr. Nadal also advises members of Congress on scientific issues pertaining to proposed legislation. He writes the popular and well-reading blog, Coming Home, which integrates the truth of science with the teachings of the Catholic Church. A member of the Pope John Paul, the Great Bioethics Commission, the Commission for Reproductive Health Service Standards, and advisory boards and boards of directors for several pro-life organizations, Dr. Nadal and his wife, Regina, homeschool their three children. Without further ado, Dr. Gerard Nadal.
Maybe we could begin in a word of prayer. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Lord Jesus, you promised your apostles that you would send them your Holy Spirit, and that your Holy Spirit would lead them to all truth. We ask you to pour out your Spirit tonight on this Pentecost Sunday as we consider some very hard truths that must be spoken, and must be spoken in your name because they speak to the glory and the beauty of your creation. So we ask you to be with us, Lord, to open our minds and hearts. Help us to receive the message that you have for us this evening regarding the beauty of your creation. And we pray our Lady, Queen of the Holy Apostles, pray for us. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. I'll put this here. First of all, on behalf of Father Douglas Mosey, our president and rector, I'd like to welcome all of you here to Holy Apostles. I hope you've had a good day thus far. Good. Okay. Well, I left my children across the way. My youngest is 10 years old, and she said to me today, what are you going to talk about tonight? And I kind of groaned. And I said, well, I'm going to talk about things that some people do, chemicals they take, and things they do to their bodies to make them not have babies. So she said, well, don't most of those people there have kids already? And I said, well, they do. And she said, well, then what's the point? So I said, well, they have to tell this to other people that maybe need to hear this who don't have babies yet. And she said, oh, okay. So we left them over there with my wife and a bunch of the other children tonight. So we can talk rather frankly here this evening. And it will be a frank discussion of some hard scientific truth, okay? So maybe I should begin at the beginning. Back in the 1980s, I was in St. Joseph's Seminary for a year and I decided to leave and become a scientist, but a bunch of my buddies got ordained. And they were, you know, saying to me when I was in graduate school, as I was doing my doctorate, Hey, you know, there's a lot of literature that people are talking about out there that say that there's a link between birth control, oral contraceptives, and breast cancer. And that there's a link between abortion and breast cancer. And the way they were talking about it just seemed just so incredible to believe. I said, look, guys, you don't need to start straining scientific gnats and chasing butterflies in order to communicate that abortion is wrong. I mean, really, this sounds over the top. And they kept saying, because I'm a microbiologist, so I'm dealing with bacteria, viruses, you know, I'm not dealing on that side of the medical community. And they said, we think you should take a look into it. I said, yeah, in my abundant free time, sure. But they kept it up, and so I began to look at, I said, you know what, maybe I'll just do this so I can show them where they're going wrong, and we'll leave it at that, and they can get back on message from the theological perspective. So I began to read the literature, the medical literature. And I uncovered paper after paper after paper after paper. And the stack on my desk started growing like this, and then like this, and then like this. And then I have a stack about this tall now of papers that were done by top-tier professionals, published in top-tier peer-reviewed scientific journals, that indeed establish a link between abortion and breast cancer, between oral contraceptive use and breast cancer. So I think we'll start there and we'll march through some of the other some of the other topics as we go along. Is Father Tony here, by the way? Or Dr. Muscola? Judy, would you do me a favor? Can you give me the high sign like in about 30 minutes? Never turn a professor loose without a clock. Okay? Thanks. So, you know, like just give me the high sign after about 30 minutes and I can open it up for questions and answers. Well, in considering the literature that links oral contraceptive use and breast cancer, I think the first thing that we have to consider is this. Back in 2005, the World Health Organization added the estrogen compounds used for hormone replacement therapy in postmenopausal women and the combined estrogen progestin pill, and they added them to their group 1 carcinogen list. These are the known carcinogens. They occupy the same list as uranium, plutonium, arsenic, tobacco. Now how many, just show of hands here, how many people coming in here tonight knew that coming in? All right, about a quarter of you, not bad. So in other words, 75% of you didn't know about this. And the question is, why didn't you know? It's out there. It's on the World Health Organization's website. It's there for all the world to see. But yet, if you went out into the American public, I dare say that probably 95% of the population wouldn't know that fact, that the combined estrogen progestin pill that women have been consuming by the ton since the 1960s is a group 1 carcinogen, the highest level known carcinogenicity, and that's the World Health Organization. So that's something to consider. And then the question comes in, what would be the explanation, or what we say in science, the mechanism involved in this carcinogenicity? How does this cause cancer? Turns out that it's very simple. Okay? Let's go through the biology. This is very basic, 5-minute, little lesson in biology. Don't worry, there won't be a quiz after it. Here we go. When a girl hits puberty, her body begins to develop, her breasts develop, everything goes into womanhood mode. And her levels of estrogen rise, she develops all those secondary sexual characteristics, the breasts grow, and on and on and on, okay? When a woman gets pregnant, assuming that we're dealing with a woman who has never been on contraceptives, oral contraceptives, has never been pregnant. We're talking about a woman going into a first full-term pregnancy. Here's what happens. Woman gets pregnant, the levels of estrogen in the woman's blood rise roughly 2,000%. So she's in estrogen overdrive. The first thing that happens is the size of her breasts roughly double, because the lobules, the milk lobules in her breast will double in number. The cells at the end of each of those lobules that form this whole tree of cells that produce milk will go from about 14 cells in that tree to about 85 in that tree. So there's this rapid phase of cellular proliferation in the woman. These cells are called type 1 and type 2 cells. They're immature. So like early adolescents, they're wild, unruly, untamed, and they're extremely cancer prone. So for a very brief period of time, in a woman undergoing a first full term pregnancy, her risk of breast cancer goes up dramatically, but it will come down dramatically at the end of the pregnancy. Why? Because now we have so many more cells, very immature cells, where breast cancer can start. Okay? At the end of the pregnancy, in the last trimester, the baby itself, through its placenta, will produce a hormone called human placental lactogen. Human placental lactogen is the hormone the baby makes to stimulate those cells in the breast tissue to start producing milk. All right, so we're starting to mature those breast cells. We put the kid to work right away, you know, room and board right away, okay? Because in the third trimester, they start stimulating the breast cells themselves through this hormone to start maturing so that they can produce milk when the baby is born. Now, something that we've discovered along the way is this. When those cells mature, they turn from the very immature type 1, type 2 cells to the mature type 3 and type 4 cells. And along the way, the placental lactogen flips a whole bunch of genetic switches in the nucleus of the cell that make those cells resistant to cancer. So, by the end of a first full-term pregnancy, 85% of the mother's breast cells become cancer-resistant for life. That is the beauty of the reciprocal love between a mother and her child. Okay? The mother brings the child into the world, and the child reciprocates by protecting the mother from breast cancer. Now, if the mother nurses, then that remaining 15% will begin to be converted, you know, that are still type 1, type 2 cells, they'll begin to be converted into type 3 and type 4 cells. With every subsequent pregnancy and nursing, that percentage of type 1, type 2 cells shrinks down into insignificance. So the more children a woman has, and the earlier that she has them, there's this great protection conferred on the mother by her babies. It's really that simple. It's simple, it's elegant, it's beautiful. Where does abortion and contraception factor into this? Well, consider. Most abortions are performed when? First trimester and early second trimester. Now, if the baby is aborted, then there is no human placental lactogen in the third trimester, because there's no third trimester. There's no baby. So the mother has had that experience in the beginning of the pregnancy of the 2,000% increased estrogen stimulating the growth and development of these cells, but there's no maturation of the cells. So the experience of an abortion leaves a woman at greatly increased risk of breast cancer. Most of the studies that have been done show anywhere from 40 to 80% increased risk. Okay? The same holds true when we talk about the use of the combined estrogen progestin pill. Because what's happening there is every single month a woman is on the pill, she is simulating pregnancy followed by abortion. No baby to release the placental lactogen to mature the breast cells, right? So there is no maturation of those cells. These women are left at greatly increased risk. Now, Dr. Chris Callenborn is an MD, did a big research project back in 2005, took all of the known literature on the link between the oral contraceptive pill and breast cancer, and he got a team together, did what we call a meta-analysis, where you pool the data from all of these studies, and showed an over 50% increased risk of breast cancer in women. Now this is, you know, your average breast cancers. It's not the deadly, the highly deadly form, triple negative. We'll get to that in a moment, okay? But Chris Callenport and his team did this study, and they showed that there is above a 50% increased risk of breast cancer for women who use the combined estrogen progestin pill. His study was published in the Proceedings of the Mayo Clinic. Okay? I'm only dealing in top-tier scientific information here. Okay? We're not dealing in junk science or weird science. We're dealing with top-tier publications, all right? The very best journals in the scientific community. Now, stand back from that. A controversy erupted back in 2003 because Chris Callenborn's book came out in 2000. And it created quite a stir in the scientific community because his book listed every single paper published on the topic for both the link between abortion and breast cancer and birth control and breast cancer. And it created such a stir that the people at the National Cancer Institutes, there's a whole cadre of leadership there that are radical pro-abort feminists, they felt this needed to be addressed because people were beginning to see the truth that many of them published in their own papers. They all put out papers showing 40, 50% increased risk of breast cancer associated with abortion and oral contraceptive use. So they put together a sham workshop. They didn't invite any of the scientists who were gonna stick to their guns and stand by their literature. So they put together a workshop, and here's what they said. These studies actually are a little off. They're contaminated, and they're contaminated by what they call recall bias. Here's what they're saying. In these studies, these were studies that we call case-controlled studies, okay? Now, in other words, we'll put the cases under consideration on this side of the chapel, so all you women on this side of the chapel have breast cancer and had abortion. The women on this side of the chapel, you all have breast cancer, but you've never had an abortion. Those women have a 40% increased risk of breast cancer. There was 40% higher incidence of breast cancer in the women who had abortions than in the women who didn't. Now, what they said was this. In women who've had abortions, they just remember better than the women who didn't, who have breast cancer, and they're in the pool, let's say they didn't have abortion. They're saying that, well, when, you know, you've had an abortion, somehow you have this better recall. And so they call it recall bias. Well, there have been studies that were done later, and I could get into this in great detail. As a matter of fact, there's a course I teach here at the seminary, Embryology and Physiology. We just had it this past spring, where it's basically a reproductive physiology course, an embryology course, and we deal with all of this for an entire semester. So if anybody really wants this in great detail, come on back next spring and audit the course, and you'll get more than you ever thought existed. But at any rate, there have been studies that were done, again, by the same radical pro-abort researchers to try to prove that recall bias is an actual phenomenon. And every single study that they did undid their own hypothesis and showed that recall bias doesn't exist, that this is a real phenomenon. So when they held this sham workshop, they said, look, there's not really a connection. It's just a research artifact, number one. Number two, Dr. Rosenberg, one of the doctors at the sham workshop, who's published plenty of data, said, I don't want the discussion of abortion to be part of the discussion of breast cancer. Isn't that nice? I don't want it. That's not what we scientists and physicians do. We don't say what we want or don't want. We talk about what actually exists and let the chips fall where they may. Except, of course, if you're an ideological hack, and you're in a position of authority at a national institute. So the head of the National Cancer Institute's Epidemiology Division, Dr. Louise Brinton, spearheaded this whole campaign, denied her own research. This is in 2003. Now, I have here a paper by Dr. Louise Brinton and Dr. Jessica Dahl and most of the usual suspects that deny this link, and it's from 2009. And it was published in the journal Cancer Epidemiology and Biomarkers Prevention. And here we are. And this paper is entitled Risk Factors for Triple Negative Breast Cancer in Women Under the Age of 45 Years. Now, triple-negative breast cancer is by far and away the most aggressive and deadly form of breast cancer that women are afflicted with. They're missing three critical receptors on the surface that are necessary for treatment of the cancer. I won't get into all that. It's extremely difficult to treat. Well, what did they find? In their results section, it would be funny if it weren't so deadly. In their results, they state that, here we go. In analyses of all 897 breast cancer cases subtypes combined, the multivariate adjusted odds ratios for examined risk factors were consistent with the effects observed in previous studies on younger women, specifically older age, family history of breast cancer, earlier menarche age, induced abortion, and oral contraceptive use were associated with an increased risk for breast cancer. Out of their own mouths. When the cameras are rolling, they say one thing to the public. But when they do their research and they publish it in the journals that only other professionals read, they say quite another. Now, in this study, they showed the following. And for any young woman here, this is extremely sobering, so pay attention. For women who began oral contraceptive use after the age of 22, their risk for triple negative breast cancer went up 240%. For women between the ages of 18 and 22 who began oral contraceptive use, their risk of triple negative breast cancer prior to the age of 45, okay, went up 270%. And in women who began oral contraceptive use before the age of 18, so we're not talking women anymore, right? They were doing this when they were children, okay? Their incidence of triple negative breast cancer went up 540%. This is deadly. Let's go back and consider the World Health Organization's Group 1 carcinogen list and what's on there. Right, the combined estrogen progestin pill and hormone replacement therapy, which leads to another issue that you'll see quoted out there, and you'll be told, listen, when you have a 40% increased risk for breast cancer, that's not really scientifically, epidemiologically significant. We look for at least a 200% increased risk, and we consider that significant. All right. There have been 55 million abortions in this country since 1973. Dr. Joel Brin, Yale-educated endocrinologist at the City University of New York, did an analysis. And based on the numbers that we can all agree upon, 40% is the lowest number that we can all agree upon. Dr. Brin's analysis estimates that there are about 300,000 women whose breast cancer comes from the experience of induced abortion. Statistically, that may be insignificant in certain circles, until it's your wife, or your mother, or your sister, or your sweetheart. Then it's real. Then it's real. 300,000, those are real numbers, okay? But they do this. This is the way they spin the science, you know? As one of my attorney friends said very cynically one day, the truth is irrelevant, Jerry. It only matters what you do with it in court. No? It can't go on like that. When, in 2003, maybe a lot of people remember, hormone replacement therapy came under the gun because women were developing postmenopausal breast cancer, right? Late 90s, early 2000s. In 2003, women just stopped taking hormone replacement therapy. They just turned their backs on it, you know, it fell into disgrace and disuse. And what happened? In a 7-year period, the incidence of postmenopausal breast cancer went down 11%. And all the libs in the media were wildly enthusiastic about this dramatic impact on women's health. So 11% in one context is cause for celebration, but 40% in another is statistically insignificant. Do I get this right? What we're witnessing today is the corruption of science and medicine at the highest levels. Make no mistake, when the branch chief of epidemiology for the National Cancer Institutes can put together a sham workshop, deny the link between abortion and breast cancer, deny it outright with the cameras rolling, turn around in 2009, 6 years later, and produce an even stronger association in a major journal, and not be called on the carpet, not be told to either A, retract the findings of your 2003 workshop, or retract the 2009 paper, but they both cannot stand together. When they can get away with that at the highest levels, science and medicine have become thoroughly corrupted. And you gotta be careful about what you're being told by the major media. Now, that's the link between the pill and breast cancer. What does the pill do to women's bodies other than that? Well, it does a whole lot of things. Is it an abortifacient? How many people have heard that oral contraceptives act as an abortifacient? Okay, want to know the scientific truth? It hasn't been demonstrated. That's true. We know all the pieces of the puzzle, and you know, anybody can sit down and just connect the dots because they're right there to be connected. And you can see that, okay, like these things thin the endometrial lining, and so, you would expect that an early embryo that takes about 6 days to travel through the fallopian tube after fertilization and then implant in the wall, that it's not going to have anything to implant into. We can all surmise that. And the makers of the pill will say that this may very well happen. But the truth is, there have been no studies that have actually really demonstrated that. And so toward that end, I work with a bunch of colleagues at the American Association of Pro-Life Obstetricians and Gynecologists. And they got me together with a fellow molecular biologist down in Santiago, Chile. And so we have the first ever study going on where what we're doing is we're looking for biomarkers that are produced by, you know, those are like proteins and other things that the early embryo makes as it's rolling down through the fallopian tube. We're looking for evidence of that in the cervical mucus of women who are on the pill as well as who are not on the pill. And we're looking to show that these markers appear in the cervical mucus that show that a baby definitely has existed. And if it's in women who are on the pill, and yet they don't show that they're ever pregnant, bingo, there's your smoking gun. Well, we reported out in a meeting earlier this year in February that in our early studies, we've indeed shown this. So now what we need to do is get enough numbers to make a statistically significant study. But early results are in, and so we have the first very early scientific results that indeed show that the combined estrogen progestin pill is an abortifacient. It has an abortifacient effect. Okay? Now, this is like such a grab bag. You don't even know where to go half the time. Like, you know, you go here. Okay. More on the pill. The progestin-only pills are associated with a 3 to 5 times higher incidence of ectopic pregnancy. Okay, than the estrogen-only pill or the estrogen-progestin pills. So there's 3 to 5 times higher incidence of ectopic pregnancy where the baby gets hung up in the fallopian tube and starts to develop in the fallopian tube. The truth of the matter is that women are taking these pills for 50 years now, and we still don't know most of what it does to women's bodies. Dr. Bob Scanlon, who's the chairman of obstetrics and gynecology down at Hofstra University's medical school, one day over dinner said to me, you know, Jerry, it's just like taking sand and throwing it into to a machine. You just keep throwing sand in the machine. It just gets into every crevice of the machine and grinds the machine to a halt. I mean, it's very nonspecific in what it does. But in what we've been able to scientifically demonstrate, we know it's quite deadly. Now, on the issue of whether or not it's abortifacient, you have to recalibrate your vocabulary, okay? Would we all agree that conception means the penetration of an egg by a sperm, resulting in a new human organism? Can we all agree on that? How many people would agree that that's a fairly reasonable, traditional biological definition? How many people would say that when sperm meets egg and penetrates egg and we have a new organism, that the woman is now pregnant? Even though the baby's in the fallopian tube, you still think she's pregnant, right? Okay, tradition. In 1970, the American College of Obstetrics and Gynecology changed the definition of conception to mean implantation in the uterus. Yeah. They changed the definition of pregnancy to mean implantation in the uterus. What's the effect of that? When medications are being approved by the Food and Drug Administration as contraceptives, if they prevent implantation of the early embryo, they're considered a contraceptive because you're not pregnant until the baby implants. You haven't conceived until the baby implants. Nice, huh? Monsignor William Smith, who taught us moral theology at St. Joseph's, used to say, all social engineering is preceded by verbal engineering. First you change the vocabulary, and then you can change the social reality. So this is what's going on. All right, but it happened back in 1970 when I was 10 years old. So this is old news, but how many of you knew about that little verbal engineering? How many people knew that that was the case? Scattering. Why don't the media discuss these things? Why don't the media tell us what the Centers for Disease Control has to say? Okay? Why? I'm not going to say why. I think we all know why. But let's go on. Condoms. Right? Let's get off chemicals. Let's do latex. Okay. Condoms and STDs, fact sheet for public health personnel. It's not a fact sheet for the public. This is the fact sheet for public health personnel. Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, it's on their website. Everything I get is off their website, so, you know, feel free. Right? CDC.gov. Okay? It's all up there. Here's how they lead off. Listen to this. In big, boldface, their opening paragraph, they say, consistent and correct use of male latex condoms can reduce, though not eliminate, the risk of STD transmission. I'd like to repeat that. Consistent and correct use of male latex condoms can reduce, though not eliminate, the risk of STD transmission. Now, Dr. Mascolo, are we trained to speak with those kinds of squishy words, can? No. They do or they don't. And they do with this percent efficacy, right? I mean, we are trained to discuss what something will do with what percentage of efficacy, right? When you go for surgery, we say, well, you know, you can live. Who goes under the knife with those kinds of words? Well, you know, you can live, right? What do you always say? Doc, what are my odds? Right? Oh, well, you know, and if they say, well, you know, we got about a 10% chance with this one, you know, you might want to reconsider. Right? But we don't use squishy words. Right? But here's squishy words. Now, consistent and correct use of the male latex condom means this. It means perfect use. Translation into everyday language means perfect use. Consistent means you use them every single time. Correctly means you have to be trained like a surgeon in how they scrub in for an operation, all right? If you ever see the videos on how to do this correct, you know, put your clothes back on and go to the movies, okay? You know, like, just go take in a movie and a burger afterward, all right? You know? It's impossible. It's impossible. Really. It's impossible. So listen. Listen to what they say. Don't take my word for it. To achieve the maximum protective effect, condoms must be used both consistently and correctly. Inconsistent use can lead to STD, sexually transmitted disease, right? STD acquisition, because transmission can occur with a single act of intercourse with an infected partner. Similarly, if condoms are not used correctly, the protective effect may be diminished even when they are used consistently. Now listen to this statement. This will take your breath away. This is where the CDC got to the top of the mountain and found the magisterium of the Catholic Church sitting there all along. Listen to this one. The most reliable ways to avoid transmission of sexually transmitted diseases, including HIV, are to abstain from sexual activity or to be in a long-term mutually monogamous relationship with an uninfected partner. In other words, virginity followed by fidelity. Right? Okay? However, many infected persons may be unaware of their infections because STDs are often asymptomatic or unrecognized. I want to go back to this. I just want to go back to this statement. The most reliable ways to avoid transmission of STDs, including HIV, are to abstain from sexual activity or to be in a long-term mutually monogamous relationship with an uninfected partner. No mention of the condom. This is the fact sheet on the condom. No mention of the condom as one of the most reliable ways of avoiding transmission of STDs, including AIDS. And yet, what does everybody want to throw at our kids? Condoms. This is not a dispatch from Rome. This is the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. Okay? So now to show you the descending hierarchy that the STD says of efficacies. Latex condoms, when used consistently and correctly, are highly effective in preventing the sexual transmission of HIV, the virus that causes AIDS. They did this with couples where one partner was HIV positive and the other was not. And these were like people that were like totally committed to being, faithful to one another and seeing, how we can avoid transmission from the infected to the uninfected partner. Okay? We're not talking about teenagers stumbling and fumbling their way through fornication here. We're talking about highly motivated adults. And that's where they get the words highly effective from. Fine. Let's move on. Okay? Then we go to the section where they talk about other diseases transmitted by genital secretions, including gonorrhea, chlamydia, and trichomoniasis. Genital ulcer diseases, I'm sorry. STDs such as gonorrhea, chlamydia, and trichomoniasis are sexually transmitted by genital secretions such as urethrovaginal secretions. Consistent and correct use of the latex condom can reduce transmission of these diseases. Can reduce. Here's that can word again, that squishy word. Okay? Can. Whatever happened to highly effective? All these things are in genital secretions. HIV, syphilis, chlamydia. It's all in the genital secretions. So how come with AIDS they're highly effective, but with these other diseases, they're not? They can reduce. Oh, it gets better. Genital ulcer diseases and HPV, human papillomas virus infections that cause warts, can occur in both male and female genital areas that are covered or protected by a latex condom, as well as in areas that are not covered. Get that? Genital ulcer diseases, such as herpes, right, and HPV infections, can occur in both male and female genital areas that are covered or protected by a latex condom, as well as in areas that are not covered. From the mouth of the CDC. And yet, we push this stuff on our young people. And we tell them, well, if you're going to have sex, stay safe. Read this to them at bedtime. Don't hand them condoms. Read from the CDC. Okay? We could go on and on and on with all these other forms of contraception. They're all poisonous in one way or another. IUDs are abortifacients. All right? The intrauterine devices. They prevent the early embryo from implanting. Oh, but that's not an abortifacient. Right, because we redefined pregnancy as implantation, didn't we? So it's a contraceptive. Plan B. This coconut judge in Brooklyn, my hometown, Brooklyn, New York, okay? This coconut federal judge decided that we would lift all restriction on Plan B so that boys and girls of any age can buy this over the counter. It's a progestin-only contraceptive. So now what are we talking about? We're talking about ectopic pregnancy, folks. Remember? 3 to 5 times increased risk of ectopic pregnancy when you're on progestin-only contraceptives. So here you have a 14, 15, 16-year-old girl. She's out with her boyfriend, sowing their wild oats, coming to chapel, praying for a crop failure. But when all else fails, go to, you know, the drugstore. Now you can buy Plan B, right? Plan A is fidelity, right? Plan B is, you know, levonorgestrel, all right? Fine. They buy Plan B. What happens if this girl gets an ectopic pregnancy? Most of these, I mean, how many girls really know their body at that age? All right? They tend to get really bad cramps when they get their menstrual cycle, right? And so if a girl is suffering from an ectopic pregnancy, what's she going to think? She's going to think she's got bad period cramps coming on, right? Okay? And then what happens if that that fallopian tube ruptures in the middle of the night? What do mom and dad come in and find in the morning? Dead child. That's why we shouldn't have do-it-yourself gynecology for children. But we do. And we have to stand up to this. Now look, did I read anything here tonight from Rome? Did I quote from the Catechism of the Catholic Church? Did I give you canon law? Did I quote Thomas Aquinas? No. I just gave you the science. The science that's out there for all the world to see. And we have to stand up to our politicians, and we have to say, when they try to put us down as a bunch of religious hacks, this has nothing to do with religion. Although, you know, there really is something to be said for living a life of faith. You can avoid a lot of this. But we have to say, our opposition is rooted in mainstream science. When I advise members of Congress, you know, they say, well, aren't you Catholic and pro-life? I say, yeah, I am. And maybe the Catholic Church knows something that you don't know. Maybe the Catholic Church knows what the Centers for Disease Control knows. And you fund the Centers for Disease Control. So here's what the CDC has to say, and I show them. And they're horrified. And then they ask me, how come I never knew this before? And I say, well, we don't really need to put too fine a point on that, Congressman. I think we all know why. It's why I never knew about it till I started digging. But I'm a scientist. I know where to start digging. We need to let our elected representatives know that this stuff is just unacceptable. We don't want our daughters being handed group 1 carcinogens from the World Health Organization's group 1, right? We don't want them being handed chemicals that are on the same list as uranium and plutonium and arsenic. We don't want them handed Plan B over the counter, do-it-yourself gynecology, that could lead to ectopic pregnancies and dead children in the middle of the night. At the very least, even if you don't have a dead child, what you'll end up with is a mutilated child when the fallopian tubes are destroyed by the ectopic pregnancies, or by the chlamydia that causes pelvic inflammatory disease. You know, most of these diseases, about 70% of the time, people are asymptomatic, so they just transmit it from person to person to person to person. Okay? This is bad stuff. But there is good news, and the good news is that when you start quoting science, politicians sit up straight. They're looking for cover, and they know that quoting Rome ain't the way to go in the current political climate. But if they can stand up and say, hey, look, you know, this is from the Centers for Disease Control, I think we better take a look at this stuff. The more you make your elected representatives aware of the mainstream science that's out there, the more we can turn this thing around. We won't do it quoting religion. We're just not going to get there quoting the church. Right? We're not going to get there. That's impractical. It's nice, but it's impractical. They're only going to listen to science. Science is the state religion right now. And so, the good news is that we have all the answers. The scientific community has answered every objection that the radical pro-aborts have thrown up. We don't know when it's a baby, we don't know this, we don't know that. We have the science, we have the technology, we have mountains of scientific publications that all speak to the truth. And it's the truth of God's creation. I always tell my students here, the church teaches that God reveals himself through his work. We all know that. But the church also teaches that God reveals himself through his creation. When we do good science, we do good theology. Good science is good theology, because it uncovers the truth of God's creation. It shows the glory of God's creation when we follow God's plan for that creation. On the side, when you get to the homepage of the blog, there's a little box that says categories. I've written 765, I think, articles so far in the last 3.5 years. So it's all on there. The breast cancer abortion link, contraceptives, you name it, I've covered it. Stem cells, it's all up there. Okay? And I'm happy to say that to date we've had 570,000 readers on the blog. So it's taken off like wildfire. God has blessed the effort abundantly. Okay? So. And if there's something specific that you ever need, just, you know, call me up here at the seminary. Just call the main number. They'll put you through to my office. If I'm not in there, just leave a voice message how I can get back to you. You can also email me, gerardnadal60@gmail.com, okay? But that's on my blog as well. The contact information is on the blog as well. So, but it's all up there. I mean, there's quite a bit there. Oh yeah, look, I always, when you read an article on the blog, you're going to see letters all of a sudden, like, you know, you're reading black letters and then all of a sudden you get to green letters. Put the cursor on that, that's a hyperlink. Whenever I quote the Centers for Disease Control or any of these places, I link directly to the source. See, the pro-aborts run on the cult of personality. The pro-life scientists and physicians do what we're trained to do. We put the data here and, you know, we step out of the way. And we point to the data, and we let the data speak for themselves. So I always link back to all of this material through my articles. Yes?
Is there any organization that's fighting, like, the same way they had to put on cigarettes that it can lead to cancer? Is there any organization that's fighting so that, you know, the oral contraceptive can lead to breast cancer?
Oh, yeah, there have been a whole bunch of us fighting for that, but, you know. Under the current administration, let's just say our voices aren't well received. But, you know, listen, we have to keep plugging in season and out, right? So we just keep plugging away. Yes?
Is there any way that we should be contacting other than our senators, congressmen, representatives to try to get this information
accomplished? Whatever you do, don't ever say, Dr. Nadal said. No, seriously. Because then they go and they say, oh, he's a pro-life hack. Quote the science directly. According to the CDC, don't mention my name. I'm irrelevant. I'm just the messenger. I'm not the message. Right? Never quote any of us in the pro-life movement. Quote the science. And deal, well, you know, here in Connecticut, right? I'm from New York, so we're just as blue as you guys here. Okay? But you need to go to your local representatives, you know. The greatest impact on your daily lives is by local government, not by the federal government, right? So you need to go to your local representatives, you need to go to the school board meetings, you need to reach out to concerned parents at the school board meetings, and when they want to do things like hand out Plan B in school, you need to get up there and you need to arm yourself with the scientific facts. And you need to say, look, you know, I'm quoting from the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. They've got a ton of this stuff on their website, and it's written for the scientific layperson. It's not written for the professionals. It's written for the scientific layperson to read. So don't be intimidated by that. Yes?
My second question would be, working with the Relay for Life, the American Cancer Society, they claim they did a study about the link between smoking lung cancer, which I think anybody with a brain would know. What group do you claim for the binding between contraceptives and breast cancer?
That's a good question. Some of the lead people who've pulled all this together, Dr. Joel Brind at the City University of New York is probably the earliest to pull this together. Dr. Angela Lanfranchi is a world-renowned breast surgeon, Robert Wood Johnson in New Jersey. Angela Lanfranchi is a warrior on this because she cuts off breasts for a living, and it just, you know? I mean, like, it horrifies her, so she's got a great voice of authority, and she uses it. Dr. Chris Callenhorn out in Pennsylvania has a book out on this, you know, on the link, and I'm going to be working with him to update the book because it's in need of a serious update. There's been an avalanche of information just in the last 10 years that's not covered in his book. Karen Malik of the Coalition on Abortion Breast Cancer, you should go there, the Coalition on Abortion Breast Cancer. Karen Malik is encyclopedic in her knowledge of the literature. And for a scientific layperson, she puts all of us to shame in the scientific community. She's amazing. So the Coalition on Abortion Breast Cancer, Lanfranchi and Brind run the Breast Cancer Prevention Institute, so you could look them up online as well. So there's a number of groups out there. There's a lot of people plugging away at this. If I could ask just, if anyone else has any other questions, I'd be happy to answer them over there as we have dessert, because I know that we want to move things along here, right? I don't want Seal to shoot me. So thank you very much. I appreciate it. God bless you.